If we can have our panelists for our next panel, it's called Trailblazers and Sovereignty Protectors. If, as the panelists make their way up, I'm going to go ahead and introduce to you their moderator. We have with us today Suzan Harjo. She is Cheyenne and Hodulgee Muscogee. Suzan has helped Native peoples protect sacred places and recover more than 1 million acres of land. She has developed key laws in 5 decades to promote and protect Native nations, sovereignty, children, arts, cultures, lands, languages, religious freedom, repatriation, sacred places, and water. President of the Morning Star Institute and an award-winning columnist for Indian Country Today Media Network, Suzan Harjo, we are excited to have you with us to moderate this panel. And of course, one of Suzan's most prestigious awards was given to her by President Obama. She was honored as a Presidential Medal of Freedom awardee in 2014. Please join me in welcoming Suzan Harjo.
Thank you, Suzan. I'm Patsy Phillips. I'm a member of the Cherokee Nation from Oklahoma, and I am currently the director for the IAIA Museum of Contemporary Native Arts. I used to work at NMAI from 2000 till 2008, and I was honored to work here, be part of the opening, and be part of a really great team that most of them are still here, so it's good to see them. So I'm honored to be here today. Thank you.
And our second panelist is Lois Risling.
Good morning. My name is Lois Risling. I'm an enrolled member of the Hupa Valley Tribe in Northern California. My father's people were Karuks from upriver, and my mother's, his mother's people were Yuroks from downriver, from the Hupa tribe. I'm currently living on the Hupa Reservation, and I work part of the time with the land office for the tribe. For many years, I worked in academe at Humboldt State University. And I have 2 children, both adults, 1 grandchild, and my husband is also a Hupa tribal member. And I'm happy to be here today.
Thank you. And our final panelist is Mary Hudetz.
Thanks, Suzan. Hopefully everyone can hear me. Can you? Okay, sorry. I'm Mary. I am a member of the Crow Tribe and a member of the Whistling Water Clan within the Crow Tribe. I'm a journalist. I've, in addition to actually being a journalist, I work for the Associated Press. I'm a reporter based in Albuquerque, New Mexico. I've also been an advocate for Native journalists as the president of the Native American Journalists Association. I just wrapped up my term recently. So, and then in addition to that, I've had a chance to cover some of the, or at least write about from a distance, some of the great events at NMAI as editor of Native Peoples Magazine.
A few non-program notes about myself. I'm one of the founders of the National Museum of the American Indian, and was lucky enough to be part of a coalition that began working toward it in 1967. So we worked from 67 to 89 to get the legislation, and then from 67 to 2004 to actually get this magnificent structure that you're in today. And I really enjoyed almost all of that work, even when we were fighting and fighting mad with people who were much more powerful than we, and we won. And we won everything we wanted. And so I always feel that when I come for a program here or an event or just to meet with someone, I think this is the place we built. So welcome. We're here to talk about trails we've blazed and how those achievements or how that work has benefited or advanced our nations. Our Cheyenne people, I'm an enrolled Cheyenne citizen of the Cheyenne and Arapaho tribes in Oklahoma, and my dad was Muscogee, and I was raised both in our Cheyenne ways and our Muscogee ways, so I always say I'm both things. And I'm Hodulgee Muscogee from Nyaka grounds. Our Cheyenne people were given an instruction a long, long time ago that the nation shall be strong so long as the hearts of the women are not on the ground. So, no matter how difficult the path was to our achieving anything that I was a part of, no matter how strong our adversaries were, I knew that it was my job to be optimistic because of that instruction. Because the nation depended on it, our Cheyenne Nation, or just our nation, depended on it. So in that spirit, we put together this panel to talk about the women who are leading various aspects of our life in Native America, whether it's specifically for their nation or for all Native nations. So what we're going to do is have consecutive presentations, about 10 minutes or so, and then we're going to have a conversation. We're going to have questions and a conversation, and if there's time, we may be able to open it up for a question or two from the audience, but that's only if there's time. So don't be disappointed if we don't get to those. We will see the questions and think about them for our next presentation, so your work won't have gone for naught. So our first presenter is Patsy Phillips, and we call on her now to talk to us for a while about the subject.
Thank you, Suzanne. I'd like to thank Brenda Pipestone for the invitation today, and also Dr. Suzan Harjo. And she has many accolades, but the one I will point out today is that she was honored with an honorary doctorate for her work from the Institute of American Indian Arts, which is my organization. Thank you, Suzanne. Thank you for all that you do. I take for granted that everyone knows IAIA, so it is the Institute of American Indian Arts, and it's based in Santa Fe, New Mexico. In thinking about my presentation, I spent some time pondering my relationship with and support of Native women art and artists, and ask myself, how do I fit within this narrative? For me, supporting women is automatic. Growing up, I was surrounded by strong women. I had 8 Native aunties, 2 sisters, and my mother. I believe the positive influence of female figures in my life has led me to always consider the female voice in all that I do as a leader. I also come from a matrilineal tribe, the Cherokee Nation. In my current position as director of the IAIA Museum of Contemporary Native Arts, our acronym is MOCNA, so I will use MOCNA throughout the presentation, M-O-C-N-A. I'm always inclusive of the female perspective. Today, I do not speak on behalf of other women, but speak on behalf of, or speak about my, from my 20 years of experience working in the field of Native arts and cultures. In my presentation, I will give you a definition of contemporary Native arts and a definition for art activism in relation to Native art, and then show you three examples of contemporary Native art activist work and how they relate not only to Native nations, but also to the broader world. A definition of contemporary Native art. Contemporary Native art addresses ideas and issues of today. Contemporary art reflects on contemporary society and the issues relevant to ourselves, our nations, and the world around us. Activism art, also known as protest art, is a broad term that refers to creative works that are produced by activists and concern social or political movements. Combining the two, contemporary Native activist art, which is what Suzan asked me to speak about today, speaks to socio-political issues and promotes awareness raising and public participation in order to foster social change. I will suggest that the nature of being a contemporary Native artist encompasses all these terms without effort. So what is IAIA, the birthplace for contemporary Native art, doing today? MOCNA has created a platform for Native women to have a voice to address concerns within not only their communities, but all communities at large. The stats show that even today, we can't take for granted that artwork from Native and non-Native women will be exhibited in museums. MOCNA makes it a point to always consider gender balance. For example, this coming Indian market, the museum's most visited time of the year, we have scheduled two male artists to be on view, Lloyd Kivanu and Rick Bartow, both really great artists. However, in order to equalize the representation, I am extending two excellent exhibitions currently on view by Native women, Eliza Naranjo Morris, and three generations of Inuit women, which I'll speak about in a minute. My first example, of contemporary art activism is Max Stevens' Last Supper. It's an installation we showed a couple of years ago. This site-specific conceptual installation points to the effects of how the food we consume is having a negative impact within our communities. Stevens builds a visual narrative to deal with the devastating effect of diabetes throughout Native nations based on her memories and experiences growing up. The exhibition Last Supper creates a larger social awareness of the epidemic and its dilemma in all of the United States. The mixed media installation demonstrates diabetes' impact on traditional values and the drastic evolution of diet. So if you walk in to the gallery, you see this beautiful installation, and it's about a 12-foot table. It's all in white. And on top, she's created these wax pastries. Here's a detail. So there are donuts, there are cakes, pies, that type of thing. And you look at it, and it's visually really beautiful. But as you look closer at it, you see underneath there are amputations, and there are canes. And in the backdrop, the white curtain represents a hospital room. And then on the wall, she has the nutritional value of donuts, for example. And in the hallway is this eye chart. And as a lot of people know, diabetes affects one's eyes. Diabetes, an epidemic in Indian country. Also in the main gallery, there's a sound piece. It's a crow that flies over. And for a lot of tribes, crow represents death. So I had Mokna purchase this exhibition. I thought it was important enough that we purchase it, and my goal is to travel it to Indian country. So I brought a perspective. If anybody's interested, let me know. It's just a beautiful installation. Currently on view at Mokna is a Kinngait family portrait, three generations of Inuit women from Cape Dorset. In this exhibition, the three women are having a feminist dialogue about issues within their community. This exhibition was curated by Andrea Hanley. This first work is by Pitsalak Ashuna. She was born in 1904. She was among the first generation of modern Inuit artists to depict life as it was once lived in the Arctic. Pitsalak drew on her memories to produce drawings and prints that depicted the old ways. Napachi Putagu created a series of drawings documenting life as it was once lived by her people. Napachi often deals with the darker aspects of Inuit life. She wanted to document Inuit culture as it was and not as people imagined it. This particular piece, it's an Inuit man in the middle. He has killed the husbands of these five women, and he's disfigured each of the women so that they are tied to him for life. Annie Putagu draws from scenes from her own life. Annie's artwork challenges conventional expectations of Inuit art. Her subjects are not Arctic animals or scenes of nomadic existence from a time before settlement, but rather her images reflect her experiences as a female artist living and working today. So this gallery has about 8 pieces of artwork for each artist. And the way it's situated, it's like a dialogue that's happening between the three. Annie's the only one who's still alive. In another example of an activist work by a younger generation, currently on view in the museum, is Eliza Naranjo Morris. And this exhibition was curated by Candace Hopkins. The exhibition is called Forward. Morris draws with clay and acrylic paint to create caricatures to show a connection between her Pueblo roots and her contemporary art practice. This is a perspective that I wanted you to see. So this is in our long hallway. As you walk down the hall, do you know how I can get this to play? Can you help, please?
Is there a video?
It's a video, but it's within the PowerPoint. So this is a 38-long procession of various beetles, adorned in beautifully detailed native attire. It runs along our first floor hallway. The mural titled, The mural titled, "And We Will Live Off the Fat of the Land." Morris says, "Perhaps we yearn to make our lives good and to find balance, because even when we feel completely challenged, there is the unrelenting proof in each of us that we are survivors, that we are the result of our ancestors' histories, and that eventually we will become ancestors." So Eliza, who's Nora Naranjo's daughter, she's a farmer, so she went to Skidmore College, she graduated, she went back to her Pueblo, which is the Santa Clara Pueblo, and began farming. And because she works with bugs, because of the farming, she's drawn all of these bugs, and if you notice, they're all in pairs, and she has them walking, so they're just walking along the hallway, and until you get to the end, and then they become part of the earth. And Eliza worked at the Santa Clara dump for three months. She wanted to know where her trash went. So while she was there, she found these beautiful, well, these objects that she made beautiful. But her point was that they are really, there's a lot at the dump that people throw away that we can still use. And there's an installation of that around the corner. So these are three examples of Native women artists whose work inspires a dialogue that affects the state of Native nations now and in ways we can't imagine. Their art instills in us an awareness of the issues they're addressing, and those issues become part of the dialogue we take back to our communities. At Mokna, we believe that art has the power to affect and change our world. We further believe that contemporary Native artwork reminds us that what we do in this life affects our future generations. And as Eliza Naranjo Morris suggests in her exhibition Forward, ultimately, we become the ancestors. Thank you.
Thank you so much. That was terrific.
Suzanne, may I interrupt just one moment? Suzanne, I wanted to give the phone number, the text number, in case anyone wanted to text for our webcast. If you have a question, in case we have time, that phone number is 202-681-5192. Again, 202-681-5192. Please excuse the interruption.
And now we'll hear from Lois Risling.
Good morning. I want to take the time this morning to talk to you about Chihual, which is they beat time with rattlesticks over her, which is the Hupa tribe's coming of age ceremony for young women. It's called the Hupa tribe's flower dance. Other tribes do a similar dance up in Northwest California, but I'm gonna focus on what we're doing on our reservation. The Hupa Valley Reservation is the largest land reservation in California. It's about 144 square miles. It's in far northern California, about 360 miles north of San Francisco. So that'll give you some idea. The reservation is located within the Aboriginal territory of the Hupa people. There have been several attempts to displace us, to remove us, to assimilate us, so that we'd no longer be tied to our land and our place. But each one of these efforts were resisted by the Hupa people. I want to give recognition to my daughter, Kutcha Risling Baldy. She has a contract to publish a book that's going to be coming out soon, and it's on the flower dance and what we've been doing. So a lot of this information that I'm going to give you and quotes from me, because she interviewed me for her research, are going to be in her book. So if you want to track it down, you'll be able to get it from there. Or if it looks familiar, I don't know if it's me taking from her or her taking from me, but it was interviews with me for the book. When we decided to do some kind of ceremony for our women, and we had a situation where women weren't participating in the other ceremonies, not in any visible way that people could see, and we were starting to have generations of women coming up saying, I don't want to go to ceremonies. I don't just want to sit there. And we have a belief in our tribe that when you pass on, one of the possibilities is to go to where the Kahenai, who are our spirit people, are dancing, and you could go to the place where they do the deerskin dance. And my mom would say, I don't want to go there because all I'll ever be able to do is wash dishes. Where do women go that they don't have to wash dishes? So our women, girls were getting married at 15, and the medicine woman for the Hupa tribe, Melody Carpenter Moore, and I were talking. We said, there's got to be more. And one of the things that I said to her is, I know there's more. We used to have a whole ceremony just for women, celebrated women. We need to do this. When we talked about doing this ceremony, the responses from the community were
different responses. There were those that were totally enthusiastic and thought it was a wonderful idea and get on the stick and start doing it. And there were those that were hesitant. They wanted to watch it to see if we were going to do it right. Since nobody had ever seen one, we thought we could pretty well do it right. They wanted to see what it was. They weren't really convinced that it was the right thing, but they were willing to take a look at it. There were those that were totally opposed to it. They said, we did it at one time, but that's when we were pagans. And no, we shouldn't bring that ceremony back because it was against their Christian beliefs. It was against their personal beliefs. And then there were those that used the M word. It celebrated menstruation. And we can't do that. They thought that that's a very private thing and we cover it up for good reason and that it should stay that way and we shouldn't bring it back. But we decided we're going to do this anyway. At one time, the Hupa Woman's Flower Dance Ceremony was a public celebration of a girl's coming of age. It demonstrated how young women are powerful members of the Hupa society, religion, and culture. In the Hupa ceremonial dances that were consistently practiced in my lifetime, the ones that remained when I was a young girl and a young woman, were mainly those that featured men singing and dancing. These were referred to in anthropological literature as the world renewal ceremonies. They're called the white deerskin dance, the boat dance, and the jump dance, primarily men that were singing and dancing. When I was a young girl, I was fortunate enough to dance in the jump dance. Four girls out of the whole tribe are chosen. They don't sing, but they were chosen. When I was a young girl, I sang in the brush dance. But when I had my first child, I married my husband, I could sing no more. So a lot of young women had never heard a woman 30 or older, 27 or older, singing. And they were out. So the chahwal, or the flower dance, the woman's coming of age ceremony, is focused on young women and their coming of age, menstruation, the community, and the connection to spirituality. We had lost, was not practicing all that. That was having an incredible impact on our tribe and on our community. Its inclusion as part of the World Renewal Ceremony, because it is part of our major dances. We believe that our Cheyenne dance these dances forever. One to the south, one to the north, and to the east, the woman's flower dance is danced. And yet we had cut this off and did not recognize it. Women in their ceremonies, which were once central to the Hupa people and to many other Native societies as well, were targeted by Americans and the American government because of the role that women had in the continuation and strengthening of their peoples and communities. Women's ceremonies and women's roles were systematically attacked during the historical periods of colonization in California. For example, when you look at the historical record for Hupa, if you look at the historical records from the days when Fort Gadsden was the center of the Hupa reservation, and you look in their records for the militia, you look in the records of the military, you will see that Indian people wrote letters making demands to get their daughters back because miners or the militia came and stole them and took them away. When miners or the militia took the girls, one of the things they said when they were told they had to give them back was, why? They did a dance, they did some kind of ceremony. And the Indian people here had a ceremony, and that says that the girls are ready for the men. They can be with men now. So we took them. We picked them up. It was more than one letter. It was several letters. This is how those men interpreted that ceremony. It meant that the girls could be with men. This is why our people began to hide their girls, to make sure that they would not be seen. My grandmother had stories of having to run to the creek or to the spring to get water and run back before the militia got there. The girls were available, so the non-Indians, the white miners, the militia would kidnap these girls and take them to live with them as concubines, as sex slaves. Once in a while, they would marry them. The Indian people would go and complain to the fort, "We want our daughters back. Get our daughters back." Or the parents would go and get their daughters, and then this would cause a war, or they would be arrested. The assimilation efforts of the federal government focused on the regulation of the native female body as a means to force the native people to a more westernized culture and society. Do away with these dances. Do not let them have them. Whereas the onset of menstruation for the Hupa people was used as a time for celebration for Hupa youth, it was now treated as a disease and a disorder. A new definition for what menstruation meant. The continued assimilation efforts focused on devaluing the role of women and dismantling the balanced relationship between male and female. This is why the flower dance represents such an important point of resistance for Hupa people, and one reason why it was targeted for eradication and suppression. The eradication was more than just the practice. It was to also eradicate it from the historical record, to not let people know that it was done. However, without the flower dance, there became a gender imbalance reflected in how Hupa cultural practices, which was resulted in a change in the cultural perceptions of the women in society because we were no longer doing this dance. We no longer had a ceremony for women, so now when women went to ceremony, they washed dishes, they cooked food, they served men. They were not partners in this relationship. There are only 4 places left for women to dance in our ceremonies, and women didn't fight with the men about that. They fought with each other. "You're too fat, you're too tall, you're too skinny, you're too this. You don't live on the reservation. You don't live on the right side of the reservation." All those things were going down. We knew this flower dance was going on because the elders continued to document it. They continued to record it. They continued to have songs. They continued to tell stories. One of our neighboring tribes, an anthropologist, Krober, wrote, they didn't do the flower dance because they had progressed along to civilization. So they didn't do it. He left out the word "anymore." But when they wrote their constitution, right there in their preamble is listed the flower dance. So people knew. They knew this was going on. We called this young woman Kanaldan. It's specifically used when the young woman is having her flower dance. And the Kahenai have the perpetual Kanaldan. This person was brought to the Kahenai world to be danced over for all time. When we're not doing the dance, the Kahenai and the perpetual Kanaldan are dancing. So we never lost it. It never went away. It was just done in a different place. For the Hupa, in sacrificing of the young woman during the ceremony, ties her directly to the Kahenai and the perpetual Kanaldan. It's done during this time that the actions she performs provide her with the best practices for adulthood. It allows her to consider the power that she has as an individual and the impact she will have on the world around her. Whereas menstruation was conceived of as a curse in Judeo-Western cultures, the practice of celebrating a woman's first menstruation and equating menstruation with power and luck, This disturbed Euro-Americans who saw this dance, as they felt it was particularly detrimental to progression of the Hupa people towards civilization, because it demonstrated the power to resist Euro-American ideals of womanhood, domesticity, and assimilation. Anthropologists attempted to use the ceremonies to prove which indigenous tribes in Northern California and societies were more or less primitive. If you do a flower dance, you're savage. If you don't do a flower dance, you're civilized. They focused on how indigenous people celebrated menstruation. Anthropological studies of the flower dance focused on concepts of taboo and pollution and erased indigenous philosophies of power, regeneration, and respect that were part of the indigenous menstrual practices. Anthropological and historical studies portrayed indigenous cultures as devaluing women. These ideas were internalized by Native people, and in some ways they became a part of contemporary Native cultures and societies. This has resulted in a misogynistic undertone to modern cultural practices that would not have been present in traditional Native cultures and society, and an erasure of the egalitarian principles that existed before invasion. A reference to menstruating woman in the Hupa language was timnahme. This term means at the lucky spot she bathes. The tim is a bathing spot for menstruating women, but also any place you train for good luck or power. Men could also use these bathing spots if needed to increase their luck and power. This demonstrates how the Hupa people valued menstruation as something powerful. During the flower dance, the Kanaldan will bathe in each of these luck spots as part of her daily run. But today we say the woman is polluted and she is dirty, and those Indians set her in a little shack outside their village so that men would never be polluted. Not what the Hupa people said. Books and articles on menstruation in indigenous cultures is overwhelmingly negative and focused on menstrual blood as polluting or contaminating, most commonly referred to as the menstrual taboo. Scholars have declared that universally cultures restrict women because menstrual blood is unclean or dirty and that the presence of it could harm other people. Native language, the Hupa language, indicates otherwise. Okay. So this first slide shows what the beginning of the dance house looks like for this ceremony and some of the instruments and clothes that the young woman wears during that time. So the fact that the women's coming of age ceremony is the third dance that is danced for all time by the Kahenai is very significant to the Hupa people. We call it the place identified as the religious dance always place, or the place where they are always dancing, the world renewal dances. This is the place my mother could go to where she didn't have to wash dishes. The flower dance is focused on young women and their coming of age, the role of the community in supporting these young people, and the inclusion as part of the world renewal ceremonies as one of our major dances is an indicator of how the Hupa people valued the role of women in their culture. The Kahenai are always performing this dance. It's only when the Hupa people call the dance down to use it do the Kahenai stop, and they come to that young woman's dance. Now I'm gonna see if I can do this. Oh, I did it too much, okay. The ceremony was important to the Hupa people as it was believed that the girl's behavior, this is the wrong slide, no. The Hupa woman ceremony lasts 10 days. The public part is 3 to 10 days. It's held after a girl has started menstruation. The ceremony is a public celebration. Both men and women come. Both men and women participate in the dance and in the ceremony. The ceremony includes seclusion running, an attendant, restrictions on food and drink, scratching restrictions, work at the time of menstruation or after bathing and changing clothes at the end of the session. During the time, women come to talk to her, to participate with her, and to sing over her. Running is a significant part of this daily ritual activities. It is believed that how the young woman runs demonstrates what she will be like in her life. These women offer advice. She's taught songs, she's taught prayers, she's taught skills by women. She grinds herbs for her steam bath, and the community comes together to participate in this dance, to sing, to laugh. They're gaining strength from taking part in it and participating in it. And this is a ceremony that anthropologists, historians, social scientists, and missionaries have called extinct and lost. The ceremony was never any of those things because it was always danced by the Kahanai until it is called down for us. We have a very elaborate ceremony. There's a lot of parts to it, but I don't have enough minutes. The running that's done includes young children with her, and she's running. She's wearing a bark skirt, which was the traditional clothes that the young woman would have been wearing prior to contact. Our first consultant that we did was Kayla Ray Carpenter Begay. She had her flower dance in May 2001. She was 14 years old. The community came. It was a way to strengthen our community, to promote healing from issues of exploitation and violence, and to focus on this young woman. Hupas believe that it is their job to renew the world through their ceremonies. We believe that the ceremonies were given to us by the Kahanai, by the immortals, by the spirit people. They left certain ceremonies for us to do. They told us how to do it so that we could continue life. We know that women give life. They physically have children. And we're celebrating that ability to give life. And in return, we're giving life to the earth and to the world by doing this dance and this ceremony. So this was another one of our Kanaldans. She's working. We have several pictures of dances where the sun or something. Now this little picture was taken with one of those little portable, you can throw this away, camera. So when they come in with these kinds of shots, we're totally excited about them. This dance also has something, in this modern age, has something to do with identity for these girls. When they're told they are not Hupa, they say, no, I had a ceremony. And they stamped me Hupa, they said. And not only did they stamp me, but the Kahanai stamp me, Hupa. We are Hupa people. A ceremony where for one period of time, a young woman in a young woman's life, her family stops and focuses on her. Her community stops and focuses on her. The Kahanai come to her dance, stop and focus on her. How great and powerful is that? Thank you.
Thank you, Lois. Our next presenter will be Mary Hudetz.
Thanks, Suzanne. I'm so excited to be here today. So to thank NMAI and, of course, Brenda 20 to Pipesem for the invitation. I was thinking about one of the themes of the day with the Wilma Mankiller quote on the program, and how we really don't do anything until someone paves a way for us somehow. Of course, I'm here to talk about journalism today, and her Cherokee Nation has just the most amazing legacy in the world of Native journalism. But in my little world, my mother was the one who paved the way for me, I think. She was a journalist when I was a young girl, so I don't even think I would entertained the possibility that I could have entered this profession without that example. And then also Suzanne, who is really supportive of us in our work at the Native American Journalists Association, and also sets an example with being a columnist and having the bravery to share your voice when you know that perspective is needed in the world. So I thought I'd share a little bit my story in journalism because it's similar to, I think, my reasons for getting into the profession are very similar to what other Native journalists experienced and where their motivation comes from. There are about 300 of us in the mainstream media right now, at mainstream outlets, I should say, that are newspapers or websites. That's about 1% of the industry, so it's very small. And then in television, the numbers are even smaller. In the Native American Journalists Association, which I want to reference because that also includes tribal media journalists, there's about 500 members total. And I would say, like many, many other journalists within that community, I got into journalism because for them, the simple notion that our stories weren't being told. This was about 10 years ago, so before the days of Facebook and Twitter, and really the kind of explosion of online news that we see it as today. So my access to news was really limited to the local papers. I'm Crow, and so I'm from the southeastern area of Montana. And in that area, I would say at that time, leading up to that pivotal year of 2006-2007 in the news business, the journalism coverage that I saw each day when I woke up and throughout my youth was two things really. You could take two takeaways from newspapers. One was that our story didn't even exist at all, that we didn't exist at all, and that can be extremely damaging, I think, over time. And then the other was that, you know, there was a disproportionate, when our stories were in the paper, it was a lot of crime. I think, especially in Montana, which I learned in my first year of journalism school, was that the federal court system complaints were much more accessible, much more, like, complete, and so that would lend itself to these crime stories in the papers, which of course disproportionately affects Native Americans because our cases are in the federal courts. But the reality is that if the crime stories in the paper is really all you see, then that's not our whole story. Sure, the facts of the story can be accurate, possibly, but the entire narrative that's being told about us as Native people is not. To me, that narrative was much more complex. There were hardships, no doubt. There was, you know, I think addiction and poverty, you can't deny that that is part of our contemporary story, but there's also, I mean, just hearing about the ceremony, our lives are so much more beautiful than that, and our sense of community is unparalleled, and that never makes it into the paper. And so I think I've spent this purse, I think I'm still early in my career, part of it, trying to tell the more complex story of any country. Maybe every story doesn't get every element, but that my body of work reflects what our communities really look like. And I think that's the case for other Native journalists. I just wanted to kind of highlight their work a little bit. At Main Street Outlets, I think there are several, actually there's many more, but just several who are introducing stories into the mainstream would be Kiara Sotili. She's a member of the Karuk tribe, and she works for NBC Nightly News. She's a producer. I know one example of her work would have been a story about proposed mining at the Grand Canyon, which affects tribes. Tristan Atone, who's Kiowa, has written for several media outlets, and his stories are, you know, pertain to lack of nutrition on reservations, and stories about Native American war veterans that go way far beyond this much more basic narrative that I had been exposed to in my youth. And then also I'd say Baxter Holmes, who is a Choctaw, and he's mostly a sports writer, but he's written these great conversation-changing stories, covered stickball and life at stickball world championships for the LA Times, as well as a more in-depth look at the mascot issue for Esquire that really, really went viral.
So I think in my advocacy work for NAJA, and just being a journalist at a mainstream outlet as large as the Associated Press, I've tried to introduce more Native students or into the mainstream media, if that's the direction that they want to go. And then on the other side, bring those mainstream editors to those students so that we can start to have more of us in the industry. I imagine, you know, I'd say that there's less than a dozen working on at national outlets. And I always think, imagine if there was 20 or 50 or 200 of us, I think that we'd start to see some, we would not, the feeling that we are invisible in the mainstream media would definitely start to lose its intensity. On the other side of this whole work of trying to get our stories into the public and to make sure that, especially I think a part of the motivation, to make sure that our youth are don't have this perception that they don't, you know, they don't have a place in the larger conversation of this country, goes down closer to the local level, where a handful of journalists within the American Journalists Association are also working to make tribal nations stronger through developing free press legislation in their tribes. Those tribes would include, this is an entirely different avenue, but also just as important to the big picture of Natives in the media. Those tribes, I think, include the ones that have really set the example for us are mostly clustered in eastern Oklahoma. The Cherokee Nation with the Cherokee Phoenix has been such a beacon of light for free press in Indian country. They developed legislation that, as long as it works like it should protect Native reporters and allow them to hold their tribal governments accountable and make tribal government operations a lot more transparent, which I think can only create healthier nations. So following in their footsteps, the Osage Nation has free press protections for their paper as well. And that was really, I mean, thanks to many people, like I said, it started out, no one does anything alone, but one of my colleagues, Shannon Shadudie, was a part of that as a young Native woman. And now just this year, Muscogee Nation has developed the same legislation. And that one is still young, so I don't know where it's going just yet. But I think to have these major tribes kind of pave the way like that, it can lead to a much more informed electorate in different within each of the tribes. A person who's, I think, now helping spearhead the Muscogee Nation's free press efforts is also a young Native woman. Her name's Becca Lansbury. She's also the executive director of the Native American Journalists Association. And so when I say, like, imagine what the world would be like with, you know, a couple hundred Native journalists in the mainstream media telling our stories, I would also say imagine how much better we would be and how much stronger our tribes would be if we all had free press protections. So hopefully those days are coming. They won't solve all of our issues, but I think they'll certainly help.
Thank you, Mary. One thing I would like to ask all three panelists, starting with Patsy and continuing with Lois and ending with Mary, is could you give examples of the most traditional or the oldest and the most contemporary or the newest advances or marks of progress or ways that nationhood was advanced or that women, just women, were advanced by any action in your field? Patsy?
Well, the biggest one is the National Museum of the American Indian. That's the biggest advancement, I think, that we've seen ever And just for your information, so what's come out of the National Museum of the American Indian are several museum directors, and our field has typically had non-natives at the helm of native museums. So now there's a directors consortium that's headed up by the National Museum of the American Indian, but we have Della Warrior is at the Museum of Indian Arts and Culture in Santa Fe. We have Pepper Henry, he's at Gilcrease. We have Rick West is at the Autry. Shoshona Wasserman is establishing the Cultural Center in Oklahoma. Anyway, there are a few others, myself at IAIA Museum. So I think that's one of the biggest things, that we have a voice now, and we can direct and lead.
One of the most recent biggest changes that I've seen is that is the recognition by the tribe as a whole, but also by men and women, that women have a deciding role in ceremony and an implementation role in ceremony, and that they have the right to do this and that they are doing it, and that you have kindergarten girls, preschool girls, who go out on the playground and they play flower dance. And they're not embarrassed. And they know what the catalyst for that dance is, but they want to do it. And you have little boys picking up their sticks, doing their role and participating. And to me, that's real progress for women who recognize that they have this ability, and they see what, as they say to me, you're an old lady and you can still sing. Well, what I do, it passes for singing what I do, but they think it's great. I think that is real progress when it's getting down to that age and they're doing something. And you have a tribal council who says, well, I don't know, but we'll pay for the porta potties. That's real progress.
I think in the recent years, we've seen some progress thanks to online and digital media and social media for Native women voices. Luckily, these institutions that might have left women out, and especially women of color out, now aren't always needed to relay our voices to the masses. And so I think just this morning, I was talking to Deborah Parker, and she was writing a blog, and to have that, you know, direct access to the people, and for people to be able to hear from her is powerful and I think helpful. And we've seen a lot of young women's voices, all women's, Native women's voices, become much more prominent, I think, in at least the last 10 years.
Again, for all three to answer, in your professional life, have you encountered sexism against yourself or coworkers or colleagues? And has that diminished? Has it reshaped or has it improved?
I used to really work at an institution of higher education where I was the harassment officer. So the answer to your question is yes. I have encountered a lot of colleagues who either were on either side of that issue. And also I've seen those kinds of issues within tribal government and within our cultural constructs that we have on our reservation. As I was giving you examples of our ceremonies, where because we begin to accept and practice the definitions that come from either bureaucrats or come from researchers like anthropologists. I just don't want to pick on them. Historians, you can throw them in, social scientists, any one of those people, even scientists. Because we as Native people begin to accept their definitions, because we begin to say, yes, that's the truth, that's who we are. Maybe because we don't know, or maybe because we know and want to go that way, it has resulted in a tear in our cultural fabric that allows these outside beliefs to get in there, and then we practice them, and they discriminate against women. It makes it difficult for women. Just 2 weeks ago, my daughter told me, my daughter is a faculty member at San Diego State University, Katja Risling Baldy, and the Native American Studies Department, and she was talking to a person who called to say to her, they're saying we can't sing any songs in public, do any demonstration in public. Indian men can't, because there might be a menstruating woman in the room, and that would make them sick and pollute them. So it's there, and we practice and believe these things because we don't look at our own selves. And it has harmful effects because it raises young women who think that they are not as good, that they are lesser than, and they have to now, and they're getting that from their own families, and they're getting that. In Hupa, in California, before contact, we had women who were doctors. We have a debate on our reservation whether we had 7 or 10 different kinds of doctors, specialized people who owned wealth, prestige, and power within our culture. And now we have people who believe women can't make medicine because they pollute the earth, because they have menstruation. But I know if Hupa people have ceremonies whose sole purpose is to renew the earth, and they're danced by the kahenai for all times, and one of those ceremonies is the woman's ceremony, we can't be polluting very much.
I was thinking of my professional life. It's a good question. I think that things are getting better. Things still happen. I kind of joke that sometimes at press conferences, even the most well-meaning of my male colleagues will just speak right over me. And I've never had a conversation with them about it. Luckily, I don't need to name names, but I think if they knew they did that, it'd be horrifying. But there's this subconscious that just allows for those things to happen still at this day and age. But other than that, actually not so much, luckily. I actually will have to admit, I've worked away from home, away from Montana for my career, and I just haven't had the courage to go back because of sexism, I think. I love my career and what I do, so I still need the freedom to feel like that's not something that would get in the way.
Yes. Yes to your question, no. Well, you know, I guess I'm a little bit cautious politically, but what I will say is that the director before me was paid substantially a lot more. And of course, I didn't know until I got on board. And so I think the pay range is really significantly different. And I don't know, I guess, you know, what I was thinking about when I was younger, especially, it seemed like I had a lot of sexism, but today it's, you know, I just stay focused, and I mentor, and all my staff is required to mentor students, and I always mentor young women, And, you know, it's interesting what they tell me, what happens to them. I don't know if that, you know, as you get older, men just kind of get scared of you or something, especially if you, like, address them head on. So I just kind of stay focused on my work, and I don't really say, other than the salary thing, I don't really say that there's, I feel a lot of that, especially in my current organization. I feel supported by the leaders there. But I do think, though, yeah, it's definitely still happening.
To go a little deeper even on this question, in your workplace or in your general work environment, in the society of your work, what does it look like as far as gender balance? And Patsy, you've already described one of the big problems, which is inequity in pay. What does that look like across your horizon? And, well, just that. Let's leave it at that.
Okay. Well, first of all, as a, the way I work really is that I want the best person. And so if the best person is a man for a position, then I choose a man. But if the best person is a woman, if I have a woman and a man, I'm probably going to choose the woman for opportunity. But if they're equal. But we have, actually the only male staff we have in the museum are security guards. We have one female security guard. And then our registrar is also a male. And I try to keep the salaries equal. You know, I just recently reviewed them and saw one was a little bit under, and so I try to keep them equal. I mean, those are the things that I can do at the museum. But we have mostly women. In fact, recently we were interviewing for a position, and somebody said, let's bring a man on. So, again, the best candidate won, and it's a woman. So there you go.
I'm not hiring anybody either. But I think this could be interpreted into stories I write on it. I think, you know, there's no question that policymakers and a lot of the folks that I need to interview for my stories are men. That's still a reality. I've gone to panel discussions, covered panel discussions, where it's entirely men, which always surprises me, because it just surprised me that there's not an effort to make sure that there's some diversity on those boards and panels. And so I guess in my stories, oftentimes, especially if it's a bigger project, and I start to see that the voices and the people giving expert comment are predominantly men, I do try to seek out a woman's voice purposefully.
I'm not doing any hiring, but I am familiar with what our tribe is doing, the Hupa tribe, and observations about how they're handled. There are systemic problems that face tribes, especially if you're a non-gaming tribe, that face tribes, and one of them is funding. So even if you want to pay people more money, you want to reward that, you can't do it because you don't have the resources to do it with. When the federal government provides funding to the Bureau of Indian Affairs and it's not to the level that the tribes are requesting because they need it to function as a government, and because the federal government's that's their what their purpose that they're supposed to be doing, but they only fund at a one-third need or a one-half need. You can't pay people salaries, men or women, that they should have on.
have on the reservation. When you don't have housing and you can't provide that housing, your costs go up. When you're an hour and a half from shopping and you only have one grocery store, it's very, very difficult to be able to provide those kinds of salaries. So we can't even get to the point of discrimination because we can't provide the, we don't have the resources to provide what's needed for that. And when your primary source of funding is not, you're not generating it yourself, but you're at the mercy of the federal government, the Bureau of Indian Affairs or Indian Health Service or whatever it is. All of you from reservations that don't have gaming know what that is.
I'll just add about the artists that we show. As I said in my presentation, we always try to show a balance. But this particular upcoming summer, when I looked at the schedule, and I have no idea how this happened, we had only men in the exhibitions. And that's when I just decided, you know, we would extend these shows. The thing about women artists is there's some really great women artists out there, but people don't know them because they're not being shown. And I really laud NMAI for showing Kay Walking Stick. It's their first major Native woman show here in Washington, D.C. But, you know, I think that there are issues there because it's the male voice, the male artist that's really out there much more than the female.
Could you speak to, each of you speak to the place in your tradition of your nation or your field occupied by women? What is the woman's reputation? What is her status? What is her standing in society traditionally? And how has that changed to the modern time?
Well, the Cherokee Nation is matrilineal and matrilocal. So we, the female voice, the females have always had a voice in the Cherokee Nation. Now, everyone knows Chief Mankiller. She was one of our most powerful Native women. She was the chief of the Cherokee Nation. But, you know, I'm writing a story right now about Indian boarding schools and my tribe in particular, the Cherokee Nation, and how, you know, whenever a decision is made, and this is back in the 1940s, when a decision was made to send my mother to boarding school, you know, as a mother, it was my grandmother that made that decision. So I think regarding family matters especially, it was always the woman that made the decision. And I think it's still that way today. Even though I think the men think they make the decisions, it's the woman that makes the decision.
Historically, among the Hupa people, women were equal to men. They had both in political, social, family ways. Women owned the junta, the house that people lived in. The men had their own house that they stayed in communally with other men and older boys. Women could be practicing medicine people. Like I said, we had 10 different kinds of doctors. They were specialists. They had money. They had owned property. In fact, we were so brilliant as a tribe, we came up with two forms of marriage, which one of the anthropologists has affectionately called full marriage and half marriage. And he defined that because of where the man had to live. If it was a full marriage, she went to live with him, but if it was a half marriage, he went to live with her, so it can't all be there. But really what it was a system where if you had an Indian woman who was a 10-step doctor, that's why we have the 10-7 fight all the time, but a 10-step doctor, and she was the doctor for your
village. You're not going to give her away lightly, because what if you get sick? Or what if something happens, like a Holocaust, an invasion? You're going to need all the help you can get. So you want to keep her home. So you go and talk to her man, and you say, hey, I'll let you marry her, because she's the best thing since sliced bread and just gorgeous. I'll let you marry her, but you have to come and live with her at her house, and I'll treat you like a son, and you will inherit from us. So that's a little different than the little half marriage the anthropologist said because he was too poor and could only bring a bag of acorns. That was not the purpose. But so we have these traditions where that was practiced. When we have our, even our in our dance, in our ceremonies, the kahenai were brilliant. And they looked around and they said, oh, look, that woman, she can give birth. She can give life. And that's what our religion's about, giving life. She can give life. That man sitting over there, what can he give? He can't see that he really did anything because he's not pushing baby out or carrying baby or feeding baby. So we don't want him to feel left out. We're going to give him a whole dance. And that's the white deerskin dance. And that's the dance to renew the earth. Now he's giving life. You see him. He's walking barefooted over the hot rocks, labor. He's, you know, whatever, he's doing it. He's dancing, holding up that heavy pole. He's doing all the stuff. He is giving life. So that's the dance. No women dance in that dance. Anthropologists say that's because they're polluting dirty little hoe bags. So they gotta go stand on the side over there because they're not good enough. But really what it is that's his time to get life. But there is a woman in the dance. The researcher can't see the woman. She's called the medicine woman. She's saying prayers. She's standing up in public. She's done everything but hit that researcher with a 2x4. So they just excluded her out. So it is part of the fabric of who we are. Then we went to boarding school. And the Bureau of Indian Affairs, Department of War before that, sent out the matrons. These were very interesting ladies. They wrote whole books about us. But they would do things, and their whole job was to teach us how to be mothers, teach us how to interact with our husbands, how to set a table, how to use the right tablecloths. That was their whole job. So we went through that. And you know, one thing about Hupa people, we're smart. You want us to learn something? We can learn it, and we can learn it very well. We learned how to do that, and we left this other stuff behind for the kahenai to do. So we go through that phase. Then we had the phase of, could a woman run for tribal government? I mean, you know, she might have a period, and then you know what happens during that time. And the older they get, it goes from 3 days to 10 days, and who's going to put up with 10 days? So it's like, oh, okay. There's actually a word in the Yurok language that says she becomes like a man after she goes through menopause. So when I went through menopause, I was like really happy. Oh boy, it's here. Can go get those guys after that. So, but we finally solved that and we had women chair people, but we still have this other problem. So we have gone through several different transitions. Some of them we've embraced and really wanted, but others we're working on trying to fix them. So, but you know, those Europeans have old cultures, so it's hard to fix.
So to answer the question, my tribe is matrilineal also, and what that means then is that you identify more closely with your mother's side, and your mother's sisters are your mothers too. And I think that has really made for these supportive networks that are pretty broad, and they're just, and yet everyone who's part of it is still related to me. That's very supportive. It helps me have some strength in my career. But you know, I would say on the flip side of that, and is that, you know, women eat second, and some small like day-to-day subtleties, and they don't dance first, and I respect those cultural ways very much. I think that in my professional life, you know, being in the world of journalists and everyone trying to squeeze in their comment at the press conference or in other situations. That has been something that I've had to contend with and find a balance and kind of still holding on to my tribal values and this culture that really really puts a premium on humility, which I think is great, with making sure I get my job done as an aggressive reporter.
In your tribal leadership, where would you say the women are right now? And are they fully considered for top leadership? Are they fully considered for tribal council? And what other leadership roles are there that where women are found most likely in your tribe today?
Yeah, that's a good question. As I mentioned, Chief Mankiller, so she was chief for two or three terms. And so I think she did a lot for our Indian women. One of the things I would like to say is that, you know, a lot of full-blood Cherokees have married, and I'll talk about the women, have married Anglo men. So my father was Irish, and my mother's full-blood Cherokee. And, you know, it's as if my father has the power, and this is what I was saying earlier, but really it's my mother that runs everything. But in regards to the tribal council and opportunities, I would say there's really not equality today. And we did have, and everybody knows about her because there was only one chief in modern day female chief. So that's why most people know Wilma Mankiller, who passed away a few years ago. But generally speaking, it is the men that are at the top and in the council. And we do have women in the council, but mostly it's the men that is running the tribe.
We have a ways to go. We've had a couple of women in over the years in as chairperson, and we've had various women on the council. And right now there are women on our council, and we have women in Native women in some of the departments that work with the council. But it's mostly we come from a male point of view for the structure of our political status government and how that's run. It's looked at to be primarily a male domain. And I think there's historical reason for that, but I also think we have adopted within our cultural constructs that misogynistic practices that were given to us by missionaries and by the federal government and by the military when they were there.
In my tribe, the leaders, as far as I know, the chairmen have always been men, except for one in the 90s when I was still a girl. And but I think that the place of women at the tribal building is we have a ways to go, I think, to say it. to say it succinctly. And I think that sometimes, you know, when women are in there, they are scrutinized more, sometimes even by other women. So I don't know. I hope that changes, and I think that in a way that we can still keep the elements of our ceremonies, of course, and honor them, but also realize that the leadership gifts of women have a lot to offer for our tribe.
Historically and today, what symbols do you have, or what personages do you have that are female or that are women, whether they're human or not, that have a womanly character in the traditions of your nation? For example, with the Cheyenne people, there's the Morning Star woman who introduced and nourished the people with sacred foods. And she has a mighty place in Cheyenne cosmology and is a kind of beacon, someone to aspire to for the women, for the Cheyenne women.
I've been asked to go first. We're really fortunate. The Kahenai are not all guys because they give life. So the Kahenai they're women Kahenai. And one of the things that I do is I make medicine for children. We have a ceremony for children if they're ill or if they need to be blessed or something. And the Kahenai who gave us the formula prayer and told us what the basic medicines that have to be used on all children who go through that ceremony, and tell us the physical properties of what goes on in that dance, were two women Kahenai. So when you start this dance, they're the ones who are bringing you the things to do that. So the female presence is very much there. When you go to, and we believe as Hupa people that before the Kahenai were the time of the animals. And in the time of the animals, literature people affectionately call myth time. That's because they don't know. But anyway, in the time of the animals, there are female animals like blue jay and deer who do very particular things and bring with them lessons and also medicines that you use. And then finally the people get here. And the time of the people, I kept saying, I see them coming, I see their smoke. And when the people get here, you have people who are women who are very much prominent and have roles. They're medicine women. They stand up and they say the prayers in the during the ceremonies. And they're formula prayers as well as non-formula. So they have to have a lot of knowledge and they have to be inspirited in order to do this. So in all three of those levels, it is a tradition and a practice of Hupa people. But when the military came and the militia, and there's a difference between military and militia, and in California, we saw the difference. When the military becomes your friend to protect you against the militia, you understand the difference. And that's what happened to us. And then the bureaucrats came. They wiped out all of the role of the women and said, your role is to have babies, to raise babies, to take care of babies, and they made our men into big babies, and we have to take care of them too. Thank you.
I was thinking about that question. I think two things. The grandmother is so cherished as she is all over the world, but your wealth is kind of measured by by having your grandparents, I think, or people who can serve in that role for you. And then I was just remembering, thought about this in a long time, that like culturally and historically and now it still translates in some ways, is that a young girl would be the person to enter a camp first, and because she's sacred. So I think that young women are still cherished in that way. I think one of the things that really moves me is when I see those sort of events and ceremonies that kind of show her how important she is and how important her life is in the tribe. And your ceremonies, I got to learn about that today, and the Apaches have the Changing Woman ceremony. So those are, I think, would be the two things. The woman entering camp first, from what I've been told, is still a little bit alive in that at Crow Fair, in our parades, we're famous for our parades, the princesses, which is now a Western concept, but the princesses go first, and that's a reason for that.
Traditionally, in the Cherokee tribe, twins were considered sacred. So the first years of the twins' life, they would be isolated. And I know this firsthand because my mother's a twin, and she was isolated along with her twin. So they are raised to be medicine women, if you will, but they're really considered sacred. Now, not long ago, my mother and I were talking, and she said, "Did you ever smoke?" And I said, "No, I didn't." I said, "But you did." So she used to keep cigarettes in the bathroom, and I never knew. I just thought she smoked them. But she used the tobacco for her ritual practice. But she never pursued, they never pursued it once they got a little bit older, because the Baptist church was introduced, and so they got involved with the Baptist church. And then as my mother got a little bit older, she got involved with the Jehovah's Witness church. So it's something I think she must be conflicted with today, and we talked a little bit about it. But so historically the twins were, I can't imagine, we have some triplets in the audience, I can't imagine about how they would be viewed. I don't think we typically had triplets. But, you know, we had also medicine men. We knew about medicine men. And we also, the Cherokee, we had evil people who were medicine men. And we had I had an uncle that was, he lived on the hill, and he was a medicine man. And people believe that he did evil on family members, and then he would do evil also on community members. If for the Cherokee Nation, their land opened. When the land opened, then some white people started coming in, and they said that he did medicine on these people, and they left. But anyway, I think traditionally we have that good and evil in our tribe.
I want to know so much more from each of these women. All we can do, since we're out of time, is thank them with our applause and go to lunch. Yay.